grizzly bears are an iconic symbol of wilderness, ecological integrity, and of healthy, thriving landscapes across Western North America. Grizzlies once roamed over a massive territory spreading over half the U.S., up into Canada, and down into Mexico. But between 1850 and 1920, the bears were hunted down to 95% of their original range. But now, a conservation initiative is succeeding in bringing those numbers back. Some species are needier than others when it comes to survival. More than just the basics, food, water, and shelter, they need wide ranges to roam, a vast diversity of things to eat, and even specific weather patterns to follow. So it makes sense that when the neediest species are doing well, the ecosystem benefits as a whole. Grizzly bears are a perfect example. If they're thriving in an area, that's a sign that lots of other species are thriving too. Their numbers have rebounded a bit since being added to the endangered species list in 1975. But the population remains fragmented in areas where the bears can no longer move or mix with each other.
Grizzly populations get fragmented because people like us like to live, recreate, and develop in the places that grizzly bears also need. That's a real problem. And the things that we do, like building those roads and putting them in places that animals need, create real problems for these wildlife populations. All of that adds up and makes it really hard to coexist with big, toothy carnivores like grizzly bears.
That's where the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative comes in. They're one of the groups working to relink these isolated populations from Yellowstone National Park in Wyoming to the Yukon in northern Canada. In doing so, they're restoring habitats not just for grizzlies, but also for many other species.
One of the reasons we need grizzly bears in a landscape is because they are something called an umbrella species. And that means if you can keep grizzly bears in this landscape, you will inadvertently keep up to 16 other large and medium-sized mammals. Other foxes, coyotes, lynx, wolves.
And it's not just other predators that are under the grizzly umbrella. It's also prey animals like bighorn sheep and deer, and even flora, like whitebark pine trees.
We need a way of saying, this is the species we're going to focus on the most. Not exclusively, but a lot of our efforts focus on grizzly bears because they are so important as this umbrella species for the system.
Grizzlies are an ideal umbrella because they live in such diverse places throughout their lives.
They use places like this river valley. They use the high alpine areas and all the forest in between.
In its lifetime, a single bear may cover a home range as large as 3,884 square kilometers.
So because they move over such big areas and they need a diversity of habitat every year and for their whole life, they're going to cover lots of the same areas that other animals live.
Finding these giant spaces for grizzly bears to move seems like a Herculean mission, and that's where the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative comes in. They're a group of conservationists and scientists working to restore land all the way from Yellowstone to Yukon.
When I was doing my undergraduate degree in biology about 20 years ago, I remember learning about this big, bold plan that some conservationists and scientists and people who cared about the Rocky Mountains had. And they wanted to connect and protect all this habitat from Yellowstone to Yukon. And I just thought, I thought two things. One, that's amazing. And two, that's crazy, it's never gonna work.
The crazy thing though is that the plan is working and the evidence is in the maps.
We are looking for these critical linkages that are either fractured or broken, and we want to try to fix them so that animals can keep moving throughout there.
In the end, the goal is to be fully connected so that the bears in southern Wyoming meet the bears in northern Canada before their individual populations get too small.
For healthy populations, we need to have movement. You need movements of animals so that they can find mates, so that they can breed, and we can have genetic diversity. The alternative is that they'll be inbred, and we'll get smaller and smaller populations that aren't going to be able to withstand problems that come in the future.
It's not just genetic problems that face grizzly populations when they become fragmented. It also means that the bears are coming in contact with more roads and cars, or that they're forced to enter into areas with humans. As changing temperatures and extreme weather events due to climate change continue to occur, plant communities and wildlife will move in search of more favorable climates. Ecologists believe that the grizzlies are sure to follow.
Animals need to move normally. They need to move even more under climate change. So we need to allow populations to be moving from, sometimes from the south to the north, so that they can find the cool habitats that they're adapted to.
It doesn't always take a giant reserved area like Banff National Park to serve as a wild space for animals.
There are all kinds of wildlife corridors because there's all kinds of wildlife. In fact, the valley that we're in right now is an example of a wildlife corridor. So you've got this river behind me here, and going out onto the floodplains, that's going to be an area that is naturally easier for animals to move in. But then we get smaller ones too, like the wildlife overpasses. That's in an area along the highway that's been fenced to keep animals off the highway, to keep people safe when we drive on it.
Once Y2Y helps create a new wildlife corridor, they'll carefully track how the grizzly bears and other species respond, and whether they actually use the new space.
The research that's happening inside this national park on grizzly bears and other wildlife is super cool. This all helps us to learn more about what animals need in places like this and how we can live better with them. So that can include hair snagging to tell us about the genetics. It can include wildlife cameras that show where are they going and what's their behavior, how do people affect that.
The latest studies show that the estranged populations of bears in the south and north are the closest to each other that they have been in more than 100 years. Not only are the Yellowstone grizzlies moving north, but the northern grizzlies are moving south via the new wildlife corridors.
If we don't let them move in their natural corridors, or we don't restore the broken corridors, they will die. We will have populations that continue to get smaller and smaller, more and more isolated, until they're gone. We think a lot about climate change, and the work that we do to connect landscapes is one of the critical things we can do to adapt to climate change. There are so many things that individuals can do to help with conservation. That ranges from, you could spend your whole life doing this kind of work, or you can show up and help count bumblebees and plant trees.